Okay. Happy to see you all. Let's begin with our prelude, River of Lies.
Sufficient for you. My power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses, so that Christ's power may rest on me. That is why, for Christ's sake, I delight in weaknesses, in insults, in hardships, in persecutions, in difficulties. For when I am weak, then I am strong. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Father, thank you for the rain that we have received.
Yes.
We needed it so bad. Thank you so very, very much. Now, dear Heavenly Father, be with us in this worship service this morning. Be with David as he brings the message, give him the words that we need to hear. Open our hearts and our ears that we receive it. And then, Father, use us to go out and take your message and be your hands and feet. All these things we ask in the sweet name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Time for our tithes and offerings. Our urge is to come.
Thank you.
I'll break that wall. I'll break that.
better turn this thing on so I make sure you can hear what I got to say.
Appreciate an extra prayer this morning. Brenda and I have been dealing with our sinuses for the last week and a half or 2 weeks. And why I picked this time to do this, I don't know. But it's better this morning. I'll at least have my voice back. At least we lost our voices there for a few days. But I think everything will be all right. It'll be good. I'm honored to be able to fill in for Mark. Glad that he and Pam can get off and have a little vacation time. We all need that. We all need that. I know Brenda and I appreciate the time that we had when we were serving to get away. Not always as easy to find somebody to fill in. That's the thing. And so when I told Mark, you know, when we first came, I said, Mark, if you need to be out, you call on me and I'll be glad to help you, because I know how important it is to have somebody to fill in for you and how it can be difficult sometimes. But glad to be here with you today. Hope y'all have a good 4th. We stayed at home. We just did our 4th of July at home, just the two of us, and had a great time. Let everybody else do all the traveling. Millions of people that were supposed to be on the road this last week. But we're glad that you are here, and hope you have a good 4th too. As we try to make our way through the program this morning, we're also going to have communion. I asked Mark about that. I said, you want to wait till you get back to that? He said, no, you're qualified to do that. I am. I'm an elder, so I can offer communion. So we'll do that this morning as well, too, at the conclusion of our service, and look forward to sharing that special moment in time with you. Okay. Billy Graham, in his younger days, would get out and drive. He didn't have a chauffeur and everything. He'd go himself. And he tells the story of one day he was down in the South here, didn't say where, down here in the South. And he was one day stopped by a police officer who charged him with speeding. In fact, the officer told him, said, you were speeding, you know. And Billy Graham, of course, being a good fellow that he is, said, I know, and I'm guilty. I did. The officer said, well, you still have to go and appear in court. So the day of Billy Graham's court appearance arrived, and he was there before the judge, and the judge asked him, guilty or not guilty? To which Graham replied, I'm guilty. The judge then replied, that'll be $10. $1 for every mile over the speed limit that you will go over. But then the judge stopped and he looked at him and he recognized who Billy Graham was. And he said, you have violated the law, sir. There's a fine that must be paid. But I'm going to pay that fine for you. So he reached into his pocket, took out his wallet, wrote a $10 bill up, attached it to the ticket, and he told him, this is now paid. And to add to that, he also took Billy Graham out for a steak dinner as well. Billy Graham later recounted this story and said, that's the way God treats repentant sinners. That's a good example of grace, though, it really is. The Apostle Paul describes grace in such a unique and wonderful way in his little letter to Titus. You ever read Titus before? It's an interesting little book. You ought to maybe find that and have a chance to read it today. But I'm going to begin with the 11th verse of that book and read through the 14th. For the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all mankind. It teaches us to say no to ungodliness and worldly possessions, and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this present age. While we wait yet for the hope, the glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all wickedness and to purify for himself a people that are his own, eager to do what is good. Now, my subject today is going to be God's amazing grace. That's one of my favorite topics. One that I myself have received and presented in the oven, and hopefully it has been for you too. Grace is one of those things that some people, however, don't know a lot about. But it's very important in our life. It leads to eternity. In fact, if it wasn't for grace, our eternity would not be as enjoyable as it will be. It opens the door to not only eternity, but it opens, through salvation, our eternity with God and all the glories and the joys that He has promised, you know, for us that follow Him. Every single human being needs grace. Some people don't know about grace, or they don't know that they need it, but they need it, because Paul teaches us that the very nature of ourselves is to act in rebellion against God and God's will. Every person needs God's grace, because one day we'll take our last breath, and that will then be a different thing for us. Our eternity will then be with God or without Him. The simple fact of life is that one day we will be facing eternity. God has given us grace, and He offers it through salvation for each and every one of us. And He has made it known to all human beings. Now, it's sad that not every human being will accept it or even knows about it, but it's available to everyone to have. And I hope that you have been more than acquainted with it and have understood the appreciativeness of it in your life. Grace is best defined as the free, sovereign favor to all of the ill-deserving individuals. Grace itself is completely undeserved and unmerited favor that God has for us. Grace is God's riches at Christ's expense. Now that's because God has given Himself of Himself. He knows that we would be completely lost without His grace. That's how important it is. God has shown us that all mercy beyond that which we can understand, and even far beyond what we deserve, is what He's offered to us. God made His grace so inclusive. Paul the Apostle states that all humankind can receive this grace. He doesn't, select. He says everybody can have it. In fact, everybody gets it, because it's God's grace that gives us all that we have as human beings. The air that we just breathed, the rain that we had this last week, the sunshine, the moon, all these things are because God's grace, His care, is extended to us, whether we give acknowledgement, to that or not. There's not a single person that God does not desire to be saved and redeemed. Can you agree with that? There's not a single person that God says, I want that person to die and go to hell and be in torment. He never wants that. He wants instead for all to be redeemed and to be saved. And since God is that gracious, He allows every person the choice to be able to accept His grace or decline it. He doesn't force it on us. He doesn't take it and shove it down our throats. He says, it's yours to receive. It's a gift. Because of His great love for us, God in His mercy has made us alive with Christ, even though we were dead in our transgressions. That's what changes us. That's what makes us a different person, in that we no longer are have to be sinful and rebellious. We are now responding to Christ and His redemption. Now, God has given us all a marvelous gift, and that's what grace really is. It's a gift. It's not something that that we ourselves maybe think we deserve, and we don't. We don't deserve it. But that's why it's so special and important for us to recognize it. That grace, God's unmerited, unchallenged love, is ours for the taking. Now, the grace of God instructs us on how to live a new life. God, you know, it's very understanding for us. He knew we didn't have all the understanding of what it was like to be good people. I mean, we our human nature rebellious in that state, we wouldn't have known. But God says, I will teach you, I will show you how to live a new life. And so he gives us discipline. And that's what his grace helps us to be able to understand and to even endure. The grace of God helps us to live a life that brings glory and honor to him. And that's a wonderful experience. The grace of God gives us fortitude and enables us to be able just to resist the ungodliness that's in our world. It doesn't have to have the power over us that it once did. As long as we let it, it had power over us. But we don't have to do that anymore. God's grace now says you have strength and have power over it. Grace brings us hope. It even teaches us about hope. Now, what a hope that is, and how blessed it is to have that. Paul says the word hope itself is translated blessed in English. So we are blessed when we ourselves recognize all the things that God wants to do to for us and to us to be able to enjoy this new life he has called us to. Now, there are some reasons why we can have this happy hope. Isn't it great to know that in a world that's got so many things kind of seemingly going bad in it, so many horrible things happening around our world, that we can look forward with a hope to what life of God can bring into our lives? Christ's personal presence, first of all, is that part of that. Just the fact that you and I have a personal Savior. I'm so glad. I soon found out going into the ministry that a lot of people think, well, the preacher's the one that has to, do all this stuff or do all this stuff for me. I said, why? You've got a personal Savior. You've got a personal Savior you can pray to and talk to and spend time with. You don't have to have someone to go between you and God anymore. Jesus took care of that. And so that means that his presence on a day-to-day basis, and we're going to get used to it because one day we're going to be in Jesus' presence, aren't we? We're going to be seeing him face to face, and we will be with him throughout all eternity. Redemption from our sinful nature, Christ is coming back. You know, he made that promise to his disciples. And I hold that promise, I know, to my heart dearly, that things may not be so great in this world, but Jesus is coming back and he's going to set things right. Jesus is coming back and he's going to make it possible to have the joy again in life. Redemption from our sinful nature means that the battle with sin will be completely won. Right now, when Jesus himself died and went to the grave and was resurrected, he left, but he didn't take everything with him. He didn't take all the bad. He didn't take sin. He told us you don't have to sin anymore. You've got power against it, but he didn't take it away. But when he comes back and returns again, this time there's going to be a battle, and sin is going to be wiped out. Totally. There will be no more sin. That's heaven, people said. That's heaven. It is. There will be no sin there at all. Now, God is also saying, I'm not just going to come back and make things right like that. I'm going to create a new heaven and a new earth. He's going to restore everything. You know, I'm glad because sin has had this world for a long time and got it all stained and nasty and everything else you're going to contrive it with, God's going to clean it all up. And that new heaven and that new earth is fitting for that kind of new life. The promise that God has made for that means all things will be made new, including us, but the world itself being made. God's grace makes it possible for us to even have redemption. If it wasn't for God wanting to do that, you and I would have no hope for eternity to enjoy. It's because God has said, I know you were rebellious. I know you've disobeyed, but I'm going to forgive you. I want you back. And so he does. And that grace is God's acceptance of you and me and all the other sinners back into his presence. Oh, don't we have a great God that's willing to forgive and forget? Isn't that great to know that God can just forget all that? Not hold it back against us and say, yeah, I remember when you did this back yonder. Now, the devil's doing that right now to us. He does it to me. He'll say, what do you mean? You know how what you've done. Remember what you did back yonder. Remember what you're doing right now and all this. He doesn't let us enjoy life. But God himself will forgive and forget. So Paul is telling us that we were once saved to our own selfishness, but Jesus came and bought us to set us free. That's what the song said, didn't it? He paid the price for us. The result is redemption, which is a change of buying us back from that which once held us, and sin was that culprit that did that. But the supply of grace is unlimited. You don't have to worry about it ever running out. It'll always be. In fact, the Apostle Paul says it is based on the riches of Jesus Christ himself. And Jesus himself being equated with God, that's the significant part about Paul in his describing Christ here. He says, this was God making that promise to you. Wasn't just somebody of a good teacher or a good person doing that. This was God himself in Jesus being the one promising that. We are God's people. By God's grace, we become his own special people. And God himself is responsible for seeing us and keeping us as that. Throughout the Bible, you can look and see where God was working in that process of trying to get a special people to be his and follow him and do it. And they struggled some, messed up sometimes too, but God was always there to revive and remind them, I haven't changed. You may have, but I haven't changed. The process of sanctification. I don't know if any of you have been doing a little Emmaus walk. To learn about sanctification as a part of that process, sanctifying something means taking something, setting it aside for a special purpose and use. Sanctification, God gives to us to set us aside, prepared us to be a special part of his kingdom. And that process is even ongoing right now in our lives. The indwelling of the Holy Spirit places this power of divineness into your and my life and enables us to live a life full for God. We couldn't do it without him, but because he's willing to give us that power to do that, it's possible for us to do it. God gives us a good motivation. If we ever need to be motivated to do something, certainly it ought to be that we want to be motivated to serve him. We can be a part of all that he wants us to do and to be. I mean, to carve out a place for us in his kingdom, and we're called to serve him and to share, not only in that, but to share it with one another and to be there with one another. And to know that our motivation for serving Jesus doesn't come from some kind of duty or obligation. It comes because we love him and appreciate all that he has done for us. And that's what motivates us to want to do and to be for him. Now, being with amazing grace, and I chose this as a topic because grace is so amazing, even though we don't always fully understand how God, you know, can possibly do what he's doing. But we don't have to do that. We don't have to know it. We don't even have to understand it. It's just enough for us to say, God does. And he shares his amazing grace, you know, with us. I hope that that right there, you know, does have some special meaning for you. And that if you're ever around somebody and they look like or sound like they could use a little reminder of God's grace, that you could help them. And in the process, help yourself by being reminded about how amazing God's grace is. For he does richly bless us with what we need, not what we deserve. Father, thank you this morning for the opportunities you've given us to be together. Thank you for letting us be recipients of this thing called grace, your grace, and how special and important it is to us, and how meaningful it is for us to not only hear a sermon about it, but how special it is for us to know that that grace lives in our lives and will always be with us as you have promised. Thank you. In your name we pray. Amen. We're going to celebrate communion today. It's the first Sunday of the month. So we have the order of to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. May we bow together in time as we have the confession, prayer of confession. It's not printed on the screen. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Here's the good news. Now that you have confessed that, Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. This proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen. This will. That's not on my screen, but I got that too. I'll ask if you come and receive the elements, and I'll let you see when you're done, I guess. Thank you. Rise now and go in peace, and may the peace of Christ go with you, along with his grace. Amen.